Vanavond in Lollapalooza Musica Therapy. De Noord-Ierse rockgroep die na 3 jaar stilte terugkeert aan het front.
Is about whenever I used to have a shitty job. Now, you know what it's like up here in Northern Ireland? There's shitty factories. Maybe your dad works someone, maybe your mum. They're fucking shitholes. They're soul destroying. The unions don't work anymore. They don't pay the people enough money, but they find working class people to do the jobs for them. Fuck them. Fuck the man. Fuck them all. So one night I went out, I bought a guitar. Bought some stuff, I thought, well, I've got my wages, or I could go and start a rock and roll band. Came home one night, told the boss to shove his job up his ass, I was going to form a rock and roll band. From semi-detached to this black eye, purple sky. Stats me around, it's just about let's go. It's a long time that you behind. I'm walking pretty deeply as you go. It's a well-stopped part of the road. But at least we know we're looking for failure. See through the savior. Why just let her go? Is it not the same? I just wanna know, is it gonna be the same? You got this one under the belt, to face yourself in the morning times. Don't you remember, there's nothing to regret. So keep the comfort you know, I hang on to it always. Never be sick or better.
I was kind of chubby as a kid, and then with glasses. I played the trombone, so I mean, I wasn't exactly the center forward in the football team, but very kind of working class upbringing. My father works as an engineer, foreman. My mother works in a supermarket. My brother's a nurse. But it was kind of not, no one was very, I mean, my father was very into kind of engineering and very practical things. I don't really think, whenever I started playing guitars and reading poetry and drawing at school, he never understood it. I was never taken seriously. I was never that ambitious at that age because I didn't have the self-confidence to do it. Initially, therapy, the three of us, it was, we didn't look like pop stars. You know, the kind of people we'd tell everyone in Belfast, oh, we're in this band, they go, you know, because everyone else, you know, had all the leather gear, and there's this sort of unwritten rule that you have to be very pretty or very androgynous or very striking or very wacky to be in a pop band. And if you look kind of ordinary or you just look like the guy next door, then don't bother. And that never bothered us because the three of us all were like three kind of geek kids together. You know, Mike had little round glasses and Fife was this big, tall, lanky guy. And that sort of made, whenever therapy started, it was like us against the world. And it was really, really good feeling.
I just wanna know.
records were. They were blind hated completely.
What fueled that hatred?
Everything and everybody in this fucking world. I used to really fucking hate everything. I used to hate other people. I used to hate. I used to have a guitar. I used to stick around my guitar saying all people are shit. And I used to really think I never used to see any good in any human being whatsoever. And I found myself reading the Marquis de Sade constantly because of his philosophy on human nature and how it's self-destructive. And I came around a little bit and I just realised, you know what? No, I don't actually hate anyone as such. I was always myself I was hating. I think hating someone to such a degree is very much like loving them. You're giving them too much attention. So
it's the same side of it.
It's the same thing, yeah. It's the same passion. So I don't even get into that anymore. You know, I've chilled out a hell of a lot more now. Still got a lot of energy, but it's not misguided, I like to think. I wrote one album of songs, and that was Troublegum, and it was deliberately the title Troublegum, a take on Bubblegum, the troubles of Northern Ireland, and all the angst thing that we were doing. And that was meant to be my one pop album, because I remember at the time talking to people in the band going, oh, Therapy's Noise, it's got no tunes. So many people told us with no tunes around the band saying, yeah, great sound, great live act, really alternative, but there's no songs. I sat down over 2 weeks in America and wrote all the pop songs I had, and he said, right, there's your fucking pop album. I didn't realise it would sell so much, but honest to God, that's what I did. And after that, I was like, kind of, oh no, because all of a sudden people expect us to be kind of poppy and melodic. So there's still little strains of that have stayed with me. But I kind of want to reclaim the whole thing and take it all back underground, I think. I don't like all the kind of music business furore that surrounds it. Somewhere down the line, I made a pop record to prove a point, and it kind of backfired on me, you know?
But this new one, the Semi-Detached, is also quite poppy.
It is, yeah.
Catchy.
But it's not as obviously catchy as Troublegum, but I think it's a great album. It's not the best one that we'll ever make. It's the four of us at Therapy, but it's a really good introduction to the four of us as a band, and it's a very humble way to come back after 3 years. Listen to the music and expect us to be very moody, so you know if we play live we don't move about much, it's all very dark, sort of even slightly gothic, and I don't find that the case. I think growing up in Northern Ireland, the only way you can kind of keep yourself sane is to have a really dark sense of humour. When it goes on in Belfast, it goes on in places like Liverpool and Manchester, I'm sure there's places all over the world where maybe unemployment or social unrest are high. And if you think about it and dwell on it all the time, you become depressed and you develop this kind of comic mechanism to deal with it. And unfortunately, there's some people in the music business seem to think that if you are happy-go-lucky kind of guy, then you obviously can't mean what you sing about, you know. But that's what some kids want to see, you know. They want to see If they go to the Nine Inch Nails concert and Trent Reznor come on stage in a Hawaiian shirt, they would want their money back, you know. It does exist. It's the whole theatrics of nihilism and pain and doom. And we don't really adhere to that. We can't really be anyone apart from ourselves.
This is Mr. Andrew James Cairns. Come on! Happy people have no stories.
Bubblegum and Infernal Love, those two albums, we were so caught up in the whole touring thing that I think for the first time, me particularly, I probably began to act a bit like a rock star. Not maybe in an asshole way, like I would never treat people with disrespect, but you know, for the fact of wearing all the velvet clothes and the black hair and all, and it wasn't really me, you know, and I kind of just thought, well, I want to be comfortable again. And I've sold quite a lot of records, and I suppose people think I'm a rock star now, so may as well start acting like one. It was a mistake, and I've learned from it.
Still, you have to deal with image as a band, like we were talking about making video clips.
Yeah. There's certain things I would feel comfortable doing and certain things I'd go, nah, I'm going to feel really stupid doing that. Just because, you know, I've never trained to be an actor or anything like that. But every now and then we'll do a little bit of showing off.
What about you, Andy?
I did the video for Diane, which required a bit of acting. And basically, have you ever seen the video? It's basically me and with no clothes on, getting rained on. And at the time, as I say, I was going through my kind of rock star phase. I thought, fuck yeah, I'll do it. And it involved me in this warehouse covered from head to toe in Vaseline with about 20 people around me, completely nude. And they had like this reservoir tank upstairs which rained down gallons and gallons of water. And the director had promised me before that it would be warm water. The thermostat had broken in the tank and it was ice cold, and we had to do that scene with the rain 16 times to get it right. So I was totally naked for 2 hours, getting rained on with freeze cold water. My cock was shriveling, my scrotum was shriveling, I had goose pimples, I had a makeup girl touching up my ass with powder. It was like kind of, I felt as if I was in Boogie Nights without the sex, you know. It would have been alright, like I've got a bit of fucking action every now and then, but I was just lying there completely nude, getting rained on. So I think that's me and the acting career out the window, yeah, definitely.
Look at this man. Is this a face of a killer? Is this a face of a man who blows up town centres? I'll let you into a secret. This man's a Roman Catholic. Now, according to all the press, he should support the IRA. And yet me, Andrew James Cairns, who's a Protestant. Right. Now, I love this man to bits. Big time. Everyone I know, my wife loves him, the rest of the band love him. No one gives a fuck about religion. He looks after me, he takes care of me. We don't give a fuck. Because that is the way it really is in Northern Ireland. We're going for peace in our country.
She goes, it says I won't go. She
I lived in a predominantly Protestant area. I didn't give a shit about religion, but if you went to see Northern Ireland, that was seen as a British team. Now, to go back to Ballyclare, you had to pass down the Antrim Road. So every time I went to see Northern Ireland play at football, I'd go up in the bus, go into the game, come back. The driver would stop at the top of the Antrim Road and say, time to get down. Put all the windows in with bricks. Everyone would be landing in the chair. I was taken as normal. Bus driver would get across the next police station, report the incident, and drive everyone home with no windows in the bus. And we just thought, well, that's what goes on, you know? It's only whenever you actually begin to see a bit more outside the world, you realise that it's quite horrible. It's a bit, hopefully there's a bit more chance now. Whenever I was growing up, it was just horrible. There was areas you couldn't go, certain colours of clothes you couldn't wear in certain places.
Why was that, the colour of the clothes?
Well, red, white and blue is Protestant, green, white and gold is Catholic. It's ridiculous, yeah, I mean, but it's just, you know, some bars won't have green pool tables because it's a Catholic colour. They'll have blue pool tables.
If you grow up in a violent surrounding like that, that must have a profound effect on what therapy sounds like.
It's just in our genes. We just play pop music, but we make the guitars really loud and make it slightly more faster. And I think that's just from what we grew up with. That's what excited us. It was our kind of release from what was going on around us.
We always have like music before we go on stage. That's kind of quite important sometimes now, to sort of just kind of wind yourself up with something before getting up on stage. You know, we're not that sort of band that want to sit and do some yoga for half an hour before we go and stand and relax and do all this stuff.
I'm going to listen to the Nashville Pussies, whose album Let Them Eat Pussy. Yeah! Quite a hedonistic person, and I'm I've always been like that. I always do things too far. I just was under pressure, and instead of kind of facing up to it, I just took too many drugs. I never actually sunk into the depths of hell. I was never lying in a gutter having shat my pants with a syringe in my arm. You know, I never got to that stage. But I just think I tried to shut everything else out. I wasn't the kind of person who'd go out into clubs and sit in a toilet doing cocaine all night. Everything I did was like in a small environment.
So it wasn't like living out the rock and roll life?
Not really, no, unless you kind of taking a couple of lines of speed and watching six movies in a row. That was how rock and roll got, you know. And I never was, used to drink a lot. I'm not really the kind of Guns N' Roses type of guy, you know. I mean, I would get off my head, but I would do something with it. I would do something constructive with it. But in the end, when use turns into abuse, it becomes destructive. Big time.
You look so tiny, so very unimportant. I'm nearly there, and everything feels fine. Don't wanna look behind me. Don't wanna look behind me. Every move and every
South America, right? Which is the worst place you want to go if you're taking drugs. We did a tour of South America, and I came back from that tour and looked at myself, and I'd lost so much weight. I was like, I had big bags under my eyes, like really gaunt, grey skin. And I hadn't written any more songs. And I just thought, I want to kind of make myself happy again. I want to get happy. And it was easy enough to do. You know, I'm not the kind of person who has to go into rehab or anything like that. I'm quite strong-willed. And a great deal of the lyrics were written, I stopped drinking and doing drugs. I mean, I still drink, but I stopped drinking to excess, and I stopped altogether. Stopped eating chocolate, drinking coffee, drinking alcohol, smoking and taking drugs for 6 months.
That's all the good things.
And for 4 months, I couldn't sleep. I had so much energy and thoughts. And so a lot of the lyrics were actually written. Stuff like Tightrope Walker off the album and Tramline were all actually written late at night when I couldn't sleep. Tightrope Walker was about 20 pages long originally. It was just about one night where I couldn't sleep. So I wrote constantly for about 6 hours about the goings-on outside a flat in London, watching people come and go until about 5 o'clock in the morning when the milkman arrived.
High above this city, I watch a big sea of people all dead in the droves. Some shuffle in silence, some gauze, sucking out silicone. I've got the institution. Watch my fat, 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 rolling fast. Hold on, boy. I feel alive. Don't wanna be alive. Don't wanna.
On a personal level, what does making music mean to you?
Until I started doing this, I hate to use the term professionally as a musician. It's amazing. I don't know how I lived. When I left school at 18, I started doing this when I was 23, 24. I don't know how I had like 6 years not doing anything creatively. I'd play stuff in my bedroom, but I never got off my ass and recorded anything. I don't know how I ever let those 6 years go, and it's taught me the lesson that no matter what else I do in the rest of my life, now it has to be creative, some form or other. And just, you know, I think that's what was meant to do. It's meant to do something creative, regardless of what it is. It might be origami, might be the next step, you never know, but don't make me go back to the factory.